Hello everyone, a warm welcome to you all in Forensic Hunt channel. So today in this video we are going to study about the pugmark impressions, that is how to lift or take the impressions of a pugmark. So by this video you would be able to understand the different ways of taking the impression of pugmarks, that is with the help of a PIP, which is pug impression pad, or you can lift it with the help of POP, which is plaster of Paris, or you can take it as an evidence in the form of a photography. So first of all we will start with the basic conditions that would be required for a good pug impressions. As soil condition dictate the quality of the pug mark formed, the ideal condition of taking consecutive 4-5 pug marks would be to lift the pug mark made in similar soil condition. We need at least 4-5 consecutive pug marks to take the measurement like strike length, step length that we have already discussed in our previous video of pug mark. So the condition of the similar soil is never possible under the natural circumstances, as the soil condition varies substantially in different parts of the same forest. This problem is overcome through the creation of a man-made pug impression pad. So the pug impression pads are also called as PIPs, and it is a patch of a dusty earth created manually for getting a good pug impressions. If you go with the length of it, it is generally of 2 meter long, so that to cover around 3 to 4 pug marks, and it covers the entire width of the road wherever you are going to make this PIP. So PIP are laid along the routes where tiger and leopards are likely to move or where they are known to be very frequent. A PIP site should be as such selected so that the animal find it difficult to bypass or avoid walking over it. As animals are sometimes weary of stepping on newly prepared PIPs, thus the soil used for making the PIP should preferably be from the same surrounding area. Now we are going to study how to lay the PIP. So the first part is to dig up the surface of the earth at least to the depth of 10 cm and then cover the length of 2 meter and to cover the total width. So as here it is written, dig up to 10 cm, that is the depth would be 10 cm, track to 2 meter, the length would be 2 meter and the width would be the entire width of the road. So the next step after that would be to collect the earth at one place. So whatever the material you dig out, you have to collect it at one place. And afterwards, you have to use a wire mesh to sift a layer of fine dust on the mark strip. So what you can do is, you can use the same earth material which you have extracted, but now you are going to sieve it so that a particular size, the fine dust of the earth material would be collected into that particular region. Once you are done with the sieving process, now level the dust after the strip is filled and place the natural obstruction on the sides to discourage bypassing of the PIP. What does it mean? Once you are done with making the PIP, now you have to put the hurdles or obstruction to all the other possible pathway so that the animal have no other choice rather than passing through this PIP's passage. There are certain factors that need to be considered. First of all, pug marks are likely to be disturbed by many factors such as the movement of vehicle during counting operations. So vehicle drivers should be asked to avoid main track near PIPs. After every check, the PIP must be wiped clean and all the debris like leaf litter, sticks, etc. must be removed and PIPs got ready to receive fresh pug marks. Now, there are a number of ways through which you would be able to take those impressions or lift impressions which are formed on the PIPs or on normal passage. So there is a kit that would be required to follow up the lifting procedure of the pug marks. So the first number represents the tiger tracer, second number represents the sketch pen, third number represents the ball pen, fourth number represents a form D, fifth number represents a water jug, sixth number represents a 2 meter long measuring tape, seventh number represents a mug, 8th number represents a plaster of Paris, which is of medical grade. 7th number represents a flexible aluminium strips, and 10th number represents a census bag. So first of all, we will start one by one. So the first number, which I told you, the Tiger Tracer, what is it actually? It is actually a 25 centimeter into 20 centimeter of glass or plastic with a 2 centimeter broad wooden framework. And at the four corners of the frame, it has the nails or screw to maintain the level so that it would be placed horizontally. Now, wherever you find a pug mark, you have to simply place this Tiger Tracer over the pug mark, level it on the surface. And now, as it is a transparent plastic or a glass, just draw the visual that you would be able to view through the glass. So the correct position to trace a pug mark on a Tiger Tracer is to keep the tracer as close to the pug mark as possible. Tracer should be parallel to the pug mark and kneel down near the pug mark. Tracer should keep their eyes directly above the pug mark and rest his elbow on the ground and hold the sketch pen so as to allow the free movement. Now, tracer is supposed to trace the outline of the pad and all four toes onto the glass surface of the tracer. So, once the tracer is done with the tracing, now a Form D would be filled by a beat officer. So, he have to write the following details like the name of the beat officer, its position, range, division, date, and location of the pug mark like duty road, moist earth, sand, mud, or PIP, that is on the pug impression pads, name of the river bank, age of the pug mark could be estimated based upon the last visit. So if you have visited a place day before yesterday, so you can for sure say that as it was not present at that point of time, so this particular pug mark would be nearly to 2 days old or lesser than that. And time of tracing, at what time you are tracing, and the direction of walk, that is according to the route, whether is it towards some particular landmark or away from that particular landmark. Now the next thing is you have to take the measurement of stride length during the normal walk, which we have studied again in the previous video, that how to take the stride length. And it is preferred to take the hind pug to hind pug because hind one is less distorted as compared to the front pug. So you have to take both stride length, that is from left hind pug to left hind pug, as well as from right hind pug to right hind pug. Now once you are done with all this thing, so there is a free space which is left here in the Form D, and this space would be filled by the tracing of the pug mark. So this paper, that's why is required to be very thin and transparent paper. So once you have filled the details, so next thing what you have to do is whatever the marks you have taken on the tracer, you have to put the form on that particular area. And as the sheet is quite translucent in nature, so you would be able to visualize the sketch on the Form D in the presence of light. So upon visualization, you have to just draw the sketch as you can do in the case of a tracing. So if we go with one by one step of the procedure, place the reverse side of the Form D on the glass with the pug mark tracing, and then sit down comfortably facing the sun. Now hold the paper and the frame tracer in such a manner that the paper remains firm in the position and allows space for tracing of pug mark outline. Now hold up the equipment so that the pug mark tracing is visible through the forearm and trace the outline of the pug mark on the paper using a ball pen. Now once you are done with the tracing of the pug mark, the next thing you can go for is the photography. And even photography could be done at the first place and then the tracing could be done, and either of way is possible. So for the photography, you can take two photographs. One is the broad view in which all the pug marks would be covered in a single photograph, and then a close-up photograph where you have to take at 90 degree angle for each pug mark individually. Once you are done with the photography, tracing is also done. The last thing that you can go for is to make the cast through the plaster of Paris. So So the component that would be required to make the cast is the plaster of Paris itself, a water jug, a mug and a stirrer, and a strip of a thick paper or flexible aluminium metal sheet. So if we go with the procedure, first of all you have to take the water into the jug and then add the plaster of Paris to make a thick slurry and then stir it gently. Now you have to encircle the pug mark with an aluminium strip or a thick paper so the POP which you are going to pour will remain upon the pug mark only. Now gently put mixture thinly dusted with the plaster of Paris and allow the plaster cast to dry and harden. And you can say a good plaster cast can indicate the field condition as well as the individual's identity. So one thing that you need to keep in mind that before the plaster cast get completely dried up, it is required to write down some information like unit name, unit number, date, place, reference number for tracing, and this reference number would also be mentioned on the Form D, and initials of the person who have done the investigation. And these details are required to be written so that based upon the cast itself, it would be easier to link with the respective case number or respective history. And thus, if the Form D got detached with the plaster cast, then also you would be able to relocate its case history. So, if you like this video, please don't forget to subscribe this channel. Thank you.